said good day, sir!
Welcome everybody here to your coverage of the defense powered by Razor, as well as BenQ here for the playoffs. That's right, we are less than a week away from the grand final. They'll be coming up this Sunday for you, but we must know what teams will be competing there. Evil Geniuses will be going up against Quanta Gaming right now to stay alive here in the lower bracket. Let's jump ourselves inside the draft, because I'm pretty sure, as you're aware already, my eyes look dead ass tired. But on the bright side, I will now be more than ever alive to watch Quantic up against Evil Geniuses. Luckily, a man who will also be living the high life with me, it is my co-commentator as well as tournament admin, Ham. Welcome to the broadcast, man.
Thanks for having me. It's been a while since I've been on.
Yeah. Puppy's been hogging your spotlight, man. Puppy's been doing it.
Puppy is has a prettier voice than me, I'd say, especially when he talks like Arnold. I won't be attempting that.
It's true. His Arnold impersonation is pretty awesome. Not to mention his mind. Oh, that movie, A Beautiful Mind. Puppy was the inspiration for that.
Yeah, I'd say he knows a little bit about Dota.
Just a little bit. By the way, guys, I also want to apologize. We are running a little bit late today, and that is due to the fact that I had some issues here at the studio. But luckily, I said stop, and the whole game didn't start till I was ready. So I can say that's lucky for some people, really unlucky for others. But we are here for the game, man. Quantic versus EG. Of course, if you are following the defense over at the-defense.com, you'll know right now that we're down to basically, what is this, 5 matches left to go until our grand final. We've got Quantic versus EG now. Mouse versus Pot and Bottom will be coming up on the 9th of the 8th. On the 10th of the 8th, we'll be having CLG going up against Complexity. The winner of this will face up against the winner of Mouse versus Pottom, and the winner of that matchup will face up against the loser of CLG and Complexity. If that didn't make sense to you, check out the defense website, and you'll find all your answers for you over there. But for now, we've got to focus on this game at hand, man, or these 3 games at hand, being a best of 3. This is game number 1.
Yeah, I'm actually really excited. 2 American teams going up together. I'm always excited about North American Dota.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Canada! USA! USA! Combine them together and you have Quantic. I don't know how you can do that. Oh, USA! Does that work? I don't know. We move on.
That's not the Canadian national anthem.
What's the Canadian national anthem?
It goes, "Oh, Canada, our home and native land."
And we will stop right there. We have the no singing rule on the live stream, even if it is the Canadian national anthem. But congratulations, Quantic. You now just had that sung for you in the very, very start. We'll become like football right now. The national anthem for Evil Geniuses will now be sung. 5 seconds remaining. We just have like war cries coming out for each of the teams. It'll be great. Let's check our draft, man. Let's check our draft. So Quantic so far, Painted Gold, who has written his name backwards, going which really puppy style for that one. He'll be the captain drafting up for Quantic right now, banning out Chen, Tinker, as well as Lycan. Of course, Tinker, we've been seeing him throwing spanners in everybody's works, and it works perfectly for Melk's normal strats, which is easy split push. So in this scenario, he gets banned out. Lycan also removed, as well as Chen. All 3 heroes, great at split pushing, great at farming, and great at controlling lanes. Invoker, Darkseer, and Naga being banned out by Melk, so we're looking at great solo mids, looking at good offlane heroes, and looking at great teamfight controllers being banned out by EG. First pick did go to Quantic, so they take the big man of the trees. Nature's Prophet going to combine him up with Lashrak, so we've got a good amount of pushing power and great supports, coming up with a third pick being Tidehunter. So again, a little bit more control by Quantic when it comes to the teamfights, and they haven't really shut themselves off for the last 2 picks. And so far, Malky's got 1 more choice to go, but has picked up Morphling, Rubick, and looks like that choice is now over, Ham. They've picked up Enigma.
Yeah, this is looking to be 2 great sort of team fighting lineups. Quantic, of course, focusing a little bit more on that push with the Nature's Prophet Leshrac. Tidehunter, obviously, their big team fighter. EG has picked up their more of a late game carry in the Morphling. And we saw the power of Rubick in the Pro Dota World League finals. His ability to just counter push lanes really easily. So he's actually a great counter pusher because his Fade Bolt bounces through everything, no matter how big the push wave is against you. I think it bounces up to 32 times.
All right. Sorry, I'm just getting a message through too, sorry, saying I'm a little bit distorted. So I'm going to drop myself down so I don't distort as much for you guys. Sorry. Sorry. Meanwhile, back at your are you talking?
Yeah, and I'm talking about EG's ability to team fight. Currently, I think they have the upper hand over Team Quantic, especially if they steal a big ultimate like the Ravage. Obviously, the Ravage is the ultimate you're looking for in a team fight that you want to steal. But even Split Earth, very good because you can't really see it coming. Rubick doesn't have a very obvious cast animation. Mm-hmm. And it looks very similar to his other casts. Like, it looks very similar to his Fade Bolt, very similar to Telekinesis. So it's hard to see that Split Earth coming. And it is a great pickup for Rubick because he can combo it well with the Telekinesis. He doesn't need a setup stun because he already has one. So really, at this point, Rubick has a lot of versatility in terms of the spells he can steal. Mm-hmm. And then they can turn him into that counter pusher if they take Nature's Prophet, the Summon Trees ability, or even Nature's Prophet Ultimate.
Yeah. And then you've got Lathrak's Edict. You've got even the Pulse Nova from Lathrak can also deal a lot of troubles when it comes to team fights. And then you've got Tidehunter on top of all of this, and you can take off that huge-ass Ravage. There is just so much control you can pick up from a Rubick. But it depends on the way they also want to play Rubick, because we have seen support Rubicks and we've seen basically farmed support Rubicks. And I always say that because I hate referring to Rubick as a carry, even if he is a solo mid. It's just these early items. We see him with Sheepsticks. We see him with, not Sheepsticks, Yule Scepters, Blink Daggers. Just the quick jump in, disable items and make things happen.
Yeah, I like to refer to him as a utility hero. Doesn't really carry the game, doesn't really support, but he buys a lot of items that just does things, like helps with positioning, just that little extra bit of disable or a little bit of push if your team needs it. Whatever it happens to be, he's the hero that picks up those items to help your team in terms of buffs, positioning, and winning team fights. Doesn't necessarily do a ton of damage, can do a ton of damage depending on the farm he gets, but isn't a carry per se, isn't a support per se, somewhere in the middle.
Mm-hmm. Got a Venomancer first, third pick, or fourth pick up here by Quantic Gaming, which does lead the lines down now, the fact that Lathrak or Tidehunter, they want to put a little bit of extra farm on him. And when we have seen this kind of stuff come up, normally on the Dire side, you might think that Tannen might go solo bot. In this scenario, he could still run solo top, but it does lead more down the lines of running an aggressive lane up towards that top lane. Venomancer Tide plus Lathrak, that's a lot of slows, a lot of negative armor, and there's a lot of burst damage very early on. And Prophet's able to solo the bot lane, but Quantic are very flexible with their pickups right now for how they want to lane this. And EG, there is no way they can 100% guess what Quantic are going to do. So again, their lane's right. It's just going to have to come down to something a little bit more basic. So for them, they're looking at Morphling Crystal Maiden. They can run dual lanes if they want to. Ruby can run solo mid. And Nimbic can go bottom lane or inside the jungle. They're very flexible with their lineup too. So both teams, it can be very predictable, but it's also very dynamic for what they want to do. And the last pickup by Quantic is the Night Stalker. So they're looking for that silence, they're looking for the lockdown, and they're looking for that extra stayability to come with the damage from the Night Stalker as well as the rest of the squad of Quantic.
I really like the Night Stalker pick because it functions so well within the other picks. You've got Nature's Prophet, Lathrak, Venomancer, great pushing heroes. So you can take a lot of tier 1s relatively early, and that frees up Night Stalker's movement throughout the nighttime. Puts people in a little bit riskier situations because they have to go further out to attack creeps, and that just increases the power of Night Stalker because he can chase a long ways before he reaches an enemy tower and only has to dive a little bit, and TPs are further away. Mm-hmm. So Night Stalker's a great complement to what Quantic has already done. He doesn't fit into a push per se in that he doesn't take down towers, but he kills heroes, and that lets Quantic's other heroes take down the towers.
Yeah. Well, heroes are selected. Windrunner is our final one for EG. So dynamicness in lanes is what this is all going to be about. It's all going to be about the early starts as well. Does anybody find that first blood? Because a lot of these guys have great first level abilities. In fact, EG are awesome for their first level one abilities. So they can go look for kills just as much as Quantic can as well.
Quantic's got pretty good level one abilities too. They've got a Venomancer slow and Tyrant Gush, which is basically a guaranteed Lushrak stun at level one.
All right, so everyone's selected up right now. Looks like we're just missing one player from Quantic who hasn't selected their hero. So just one quick pause.
I'm actually hard-pressed to decide who has the better first game, first level lineup.
EG definitely does. They've got more burst, damage, they've got more lockdown. Where you look at Prophet, and this is where it kind of splits up. If Prophet gets good scouting with the level 1 trees, then then Quantic have the advantage, but it's heavily reliant on that scout and them getting a higher level of position. But if it comes down to burst damage and keep cycling through your abilities and having mana to do so, then EG definitely come out on top. But Quantic, they can find themselves in the position game.
Yeah, and I guess EG does have the one chase ability in the Morphling. He can waveform and chase people down.
Uh-huh.
So that helps him. I'm always reluctant to say that a team with Enigma is good first level, because he's either going to take Malphus to be helpful first level and then not be very good in the jungle, or he's going to take Demonic Conversion in preparation for the jungle and then not have a great presence in the level 1 fight. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's possible that EG goes top, Quantic goes bottom, and we don't see any of this.
It's actually pretty possible. And depending on the way Quantic want to run their lineup, like if we're going to see Prophet head up towards the top lane, which I got a funny feeling he will, because Painted Gold is taking up that role as Tidehunter, so he might feel confident enough to go in towards that middle lane and give Kurok the space to breathe in the bottom lane, which is what Quantic normally do. But we've kind of got to look at Quantic with a different light in this scenario, because normally if you want to say it's the old Quantic doing what Quantic always did, then Kurok will be on the bot lane, he'll be farming up as much as he possibly can, first nighttime will strike, and then he'll go ganking. That would be basic Quantic. But yeah. I'm not quite sure with this kind of lineup, because we've got Brax up on the Prophet, and that might lean him towards going up for that solo mid-roll, and that would switch up a little bit more and run Kurok, Matrim, as well as even Lashrak up towards the top lane and give Tide that bottom lane, because the rotation can come pretty easily. really? Okay. So it seems we're on the wrong host. Ah, no, it's because EG is in Europe. That's right, because they're in Denmark. They're in Denmark. There was the, if you didn't check out the news on Join Dota, there was a video that Demon released on his TV, on his YouTube channel. They're boot camping in Europe right now. So hence the US East. You're such on the ball, Ham. You're so on the ball. All right.
I mean, I said this in the lobby beforehand, but apparently players were too busy.
Oh, Holy Master just jumped in, Lance. It's like, what's going on here? Why are we... But we can chill. We can relax. It's all good. It's all fine. We had a last player just connect in now. So Mikey has just connected in a solo track.
And that sort of leads me to believe that Leshrac's support.
Yeah.
Because Mikey is their support player. So you might see
It reeks of the aggressive tri-lane on top. It reeks of the aggressive tri-lane on top.
Yeah, and that gives Brax some safety, either in the bottom or mid lane, and Painted Gold some safety where whatever the opposite of Prophet is.
Always just look for the opposite of Prophet. Opposite of Prophet, nobody. No one. Well, actually, yeah, Alchemist. Prophet is really useful. Alchemist is not useful. That's the opposite of Prophet. Let's run through very, very quickly as our lanes will start going off. So, who's going to be playing what? EG, we're looking at Demon, going to be taking up the role as Rubick. He's heading up towards the top lane. Now, there's the right switch, because I doubt that... Well, maybe they're going to run dual lane, middle lane. Fear is on the Morphling, so he always takes the hard carry role. Normally they'll support up the Morphling, but with the Crystal Maiden, we've got the option for the dual lane middle, which looks to be the case. Universe taking up the role as the Crystal Maiden. Up towards our top lane, our man who prefers jungling, and with his build, he definitely is going to go jungle. And that is our Enigma. It puts Bulba as top lane solo, Windrunner, and that leaves bottom lane solo, Demon. And he has done this as well beforehand, so it looks like Malgus is going to steal one of the creeps in the bottom lane to help him out. But Demon will stack up the Ancients and then... Well, normally they did this with Tinker to try and farm him up, and that was when it was Fear, I believe, taking up the role as the Tinker in this scenario. But Demon, he'll still be stacking that up and try and get the pull and get the easy farm up on the Ancients. Down towards our team for Quantic. They are protecting their jungle very, very much. And that does mean our bottom lane is going to be the big protected one. We've got Prophet already making his maneuver up towards the top lane. And they'll use Kurok in towards the middle lane with support from Venomancer. So they are predicting the fact that it will be the dual lane middle lane. So it'll be Nightstalker plus Venomancer going in towards the middle lane. Just rune control for now. And that leaves Lashrak as well as Tidehunter. Paint it gold onto the Tidehunter and Mikey on the Lashrak. Are they going to completely rotate up top?
It looks like they might. They might put their aggressive tri-lane top.
Yeah, they are. Yeah, they are. So we were right with our initial thoughts.
Yeah, that leaves Brax. He can play it safe in mid lane. He won't get too much farm and can't be too aggressive, but he's looking to be aggressive in the tri-lane anyways.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he's looking to TP away and help out. He doesn't need to necessarily win his lane perfectly, because he won't.
Interesting how this bottom lane goes with Demon. He's really going to be happy with this. So many times you have that offlane player, and it just doesn't work for you. And in this scenario, he's going up against Tidehunter, and while Demon can't spam out of a lot of abilities, he won't have to use all these consumables he's got. He's got them in case he does come in close range of Tidehunter, but as long as he keeps that range, doesn't get affected by the Anchor Smash, he should be pretty good. And Nog does a wise thing as well. Realizes that Matrim as well as Mikey will be hunting inside the Dire Jungle. So what do you do when that happens? All you got to do is just jump to the other jungle. So he's down there in the Radiant Jungle. It's letting Bulba pull the creep wave up here on the top lane, which is leaving Korok free space to farm, but it's not giving them the kill on the top lane. And that's generally what will help build up the momentum for Nightstalker, as well as the levels for these supports.
Yeah, this is a great pull by Bulba, realizing that his pull camp is likely to be warded. It is. And pulling that camp is a good way to die, because he's going to be way too close to the enemy team. We see a full rotation here by Venomancer and Lashrak.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they realize the same thing. They realize that Enigma is nowhere inside the EG's jungle. So he's got to be on bot. But this is also a good time for Melk to rotate. He's got 1 point up in Malifus. If they get one extra creep, he would have an extra stun point. But that burst damage probably wouldn't have been enough to kill off Tide.
No,
it would have been enough to force out that last salve, which he is down to. Tide's out of regen pretty soon.
Well, Enigma knows that Matrim and Mikey are running around looking for him. They saw him go bottom, so he's just going to rotate around and do top. So it's a little bit of extra time for him to get there, but he's already level 2. Killed 6 creeps, and Lashrak hasn't killed any. Matrim hasn't killed any.
Yeah, they've spent all their time just walking around. And that really hurts the supports. It really hurts the supports. To have these levels up on the supports gives you so much more to play with. We're talking about EG having level 1 pressure in comparison to what Quantic's got, and EG would really win that 1v1 or 5v5 battle with everyone with level 1 abilities. But now the fact that the levels are coming up for
Illusion.
EG... This is problematic for Quantic, because they're not getting the levels up on their supports. Venomancer is just so key to get that level 7. So you have 4 points up in the Plague Wards, you have his ultimate. So you've got the harassment that comes out from the Gale as well as the Poison Sting. And that's what you need up on a Venomancer to really make him successful. Having levels up on Prophet, while it is great, it just doesn't deal with the fact that he can still be locked down by Universe and Fear. He's getting the farm up 12 for 2 already here in the middle lane. And guys, like, Fear's been on, like, I don't know what training he has been doing. I don't know if he just, like, is clicking his fork while he's eating. But he's been really on target for all his last hits through all the games we've been watching of him of late.
Yeah, he's really been making sure that he gets every last hit. I totally agree with that. We've seen him just get so much farm so quickly. It's incredible. We got mid lane initiation here.
I don't know if they can find... Oh, they know. They can. They can find the kill. Prophet's a long way down there. Fear cops a little bit of damage from it. I was waiting for the top lane to actually initiate. We're seeing Matrim just waiting for the right moment to go on Bulba. Because it would be a good slow with the 2 points in Void.
Oh, Demon taking a lot of damage bottom lane.
Is he going to go down as well? 52 HP. Nice little salve there. So he'll survive the right click from Prophet, who came in. And he's heal munched it on the tank. Oh, so that right click won't be enough.
Brax knows that he can't take up too much damage, or else Demon will just lift him up.
And Demon even just mocking him a little bit there. That's a long time for Prophet to be gone. He's only got 1 point in TP and has to walk back to mid. Even ball boots so he can move faster.
That tower is...
Yeah, Fear was just able to disintegrate the creep wave in combination with Universe. Surprised Universe didn't throw Fear a sound just then. Just so when Prophet arrived back, he would have all of his life back.
I mean, he's got a bottle, so he's running around okay.
Mm. Well, that's true. Universe should save it for himself, and there's a Frostbite. Nova as well. Morbly can wave himself through this, and it should be enough damage. Second kill now for EG here in the middle lane. Down into the deep creep. Early game is not going well right now for Quantic. Two deaths down, and they both went the way of Morphling. And also the escape on bot. And Prophet's going to TP bottom lane, Universe coming down for that one. But good snipe at the rune.
I'm actually a little worried for Quantic at this point. We talked about how much their strategy is reliant on push, and they just aren't getting levels on their Venomancer and Leshrac. Mm-hmm. And those are their two of their key pushers.
On the bright side for them, though, Leshrac doesn't need as many levels. Like I was saying, Venomancer needs that level 7. But Leshrac, level 3 is quite fine for Mikey. 2 points in Edict, as long as they've got the support there that can tank it up, then they're going to be okay. But when they have things like Pain of Gold, who's got no life and no mana, and he cannot stand close to Demon, then life is hell. Mikey's trying to harass Demon right now, hoping Demon will just walk away from the creep wave, but Demon does, but he's just too fast for Mikey. There's no boots on Mikey yet, so he can't win the race battle with Edict. But that's a decent creep wave coming in on bottom lane. 2 points in Edict, decent damage to the bottom tower. Bit by bit, they should bring it down. So all the options aren't gone for Quantic. It's just a very, very rough start. And we're about to hit nighttime. And that's gonna be the telling point for Quantic. Just how much damage Kurok is capable of doing in this first nighttime cycle.
Yeah, they're going to need to get him a few kills and then use those kills and turn them into towers. And that's what Quantic is going to need to do in order to come back in this game at this point. They're by no means out of it, but they're going to have to make good use of this Night Stalker.
Yeah, but this is what Kurok does. This is the reason why Quantic is feared by a lot of teams. It's because of this one guy. Quantic's old strat was basically everything revolves around Kurok. We get him kills, we win the game. That was just what Quantic did.
Pick Morphling, hope for the best, win game.
Basically, yeah. That's what it was. Morphling, Storm Spirit, whatever Kurok wanted to play, they would just give it to him and just say, you know what, man? In you we trust. You hold Quantic's hopes in your hands.
Quantic has developed since then. I wouldn't say they're a one-man show.
No.
And you don't get this far in the defense being a one-man show.
And they were definitely more than that beforehand. It was just Kurok always stole the limelight because that was the way they did their strats. We go look at middle lane go down right now if Universe can get this done. He throws out the Nova. Nice route there, but he's still going to go down. Thrax, he's trying to get one last right click on the Universe to see if the damage from the tower can finish the job, but unable to do so, and he'll die. At the same time, we got pings coming down towards the bottom lane, but Demon's moving back, and Kurok unable to gank up Volva here on the top lane, just sitting behind that tier 1 tower. Well, tier 1 tower is going to go down here in middle lane.
Top lane's taking a lot of damage, tier 1 as well, and Demon's going down bottom.
Prophet TPing down for that one. It's going to cost him a gush, cost him a split earth plus edict. Well, that's a pretty cheap kill. My Demon was got a long way out there, and that's a level 6 Rubick going down. And there's a lot of levels for Leshrac. He's now up to level 5. And Tide does have that Ravage up as tower. Well.
Mm-hmm. It's just too easy for them to do it.
They're set up again for top lane.
They really want Bulba to... Oh, they just need to push him back. That tower's really low. They can probably kill it in one or two creep waves.
That's the reason why Melk's up here.
Yeah.
We got TP support coming down towards the bottom lane. Universe and Demon to try and hold it. So the bottom lane push does stop, but Kurok, he now sees Bulba and says, you know what, Matrim, can we please go for this one? At the same time, we got Matrim putting down some wards, knowing that Enigma's up here because he found an army of conversions.
Yeah, the great part about what EG is doing now is they've got such a good start on the Morphling.
This is the time. Silence, Void, Gale, and Bulba. TP will have to happen. There's no extra stun on him, so Bulba will manage to escape from this one. But they do force him off the lane, and that's going to be the tier 1 tower.
Yeah, what I was saying is they've done such a good job getting Fear, the start that he needs, that it frees up Crystal Maiden to help the bottom lane. Mm-hmm.
And that gives more room for Demon to breathe. We got a little bit of rotation around. There goes the TP out, and it will be heading out towards the top lane.
Yeah, they want to secure this tower.
Yeah, I'm wondering if they want to stop here. It's nighttime in Kuroki. He's got 2k gold. Mikey has got 3 points up in Edict, and Matrim's got 2 points up in Wards, plus the Stinging Gale, and that's enough to keep a push going on the top lane. So they might think, hey, let's push the tier two.
Oh, Brax. Mid lane.
You can't run away from fear, or maybe you can if his waveform's on cooldown. And then TP's out to safety. That's one way to run away from fear.
Yeah, fear can't really get kills without Crystal Maiden, or at least it's a lot more difficult. But he still has all the farm in the world that he wants.
Rotation's coming by Quantic in towards middle lane. It's not for a kill. It's to protect their tier 2 as well as the momentum they've already managed to work up. But we're halfway through nighttime right now, and Kurok still...
He doesn't have boots yet. He just got, actually he does now.
He's got bought up the magic wand, bought up boots, bought up a TP scroll, and has the Vanguard completed as well. So he's really good. Like at this point, 44 for 13, it's decent farm. He hasn't got himself a kill, but he also hasn't died. However, Mantrum, you will die right now. Basically nuked to death. Universe and Demon combining up. Latrak's in the wrong position. He's just going to pop Edict right now. He is completely locked up. All three angles out. He gets stunned up. Waveform will go, but Demon will pick up the double kill. One last hit to kill. And he also stole the Split Earth level 2.
Yeah, but at the same time, Quantic is trying to find what trade they can. They're going to try and take this tower. And they do.
Yeah, but look at the TP support coming in. Melk, he's got Black Hole if he wants to use it right now. He's already left the stuns here on the Tidehunter, who's thinking about popping Ravage off. He'll pop the Anchor Smash in a moment, but Demon's caught up in a corner. And now Venomancer will come in. Gale hits there on Universe as well as Bulba. And Tide really, really low on life. But he's hiding back behind the towers. Now Nihilstalk is going to come to join the fight. The Sprout went to pop, but Bulba, Demon, able just to eat his way through it all. And Prophet will TP top lane to try and defend this and push it back out again. He really needs that level 6. So we can spam that off, and for engagements like this, EG will lose so much life so early on. Kurok, gonna be really cautious how close he's getting. Telekinesis is gonna pull him back in towards EG. Shaka will latch him up. Again, another good gale up by Mantrum, but the stuns keep going out by Enigma, and Kurok should take a fall right now. Stick charges might keep him up. He's got an extra salve if he wants to, but the power shot out by Bulba kills off the retreating Nightstalker. And that's Kurok getting too overconfident.
Yeah. Getting a little bit too far in.
Oh, fear.
Oh, fear.
He has no replicate, but the Split Earth missing there by Mikey. Well off target. Is under attack.
Panic Gold not wanting to blow a Ravage, just because they can't guarantee that they'll kill Fear. Mm-hmm. I really like what Fear's doing as well. Not going Lincolns, not going Manta, just going straight for the
TP.
Ethereal Blade.
They're going to find Melk. He's TPing out. Really smart timing. Tower gets brought down by Melk. Kurok TP's in as well, but it's way too late. Yeah, the conversion's chasing down the courier, but they're not going to take it. Middle lane, however, Prophet is going to TP. Worst position in the world to TP into. Fear and Demon just say thank you very, very much here. And that is the death of Brax.
And Rubick's got a great spell. He's got Void. One of the strongest nukes in the game, and really, really low mana cost.
Mm-hmm. And then you add the silence to it as well. Kurok, he'll just get completely stopped. And now Fear might be in a little bit of trouble. He has got no replicate to jump off to, and he's already getting done up. There goes the Edict damage, silenced up. Split Earth doesn't land again here by Mike. He just cannot predict the movements here of Fear. And Fear goes a little bit higher up, waves up a little bit further, but Kurok's still on the chase. Last couple of minutes here of nighttime. Extra support has come in. Shackle holding Tidehunter in place. Power shot to fly through him as well. Then Kurok decides to turn. Fear bottling up. Realizes too now with the Ankh, with the Ghost Scepter up on Fear. He cannot just run after him and right-click him down. And with the daytime about to come in, Kurok has to fall back. Dire's
top tower is under attack. Yeah, this is overall a relatively unsuccessful night for Kurok. They really need to make more of it. Either use his presence to take towers. They did get two. Mm-hmm. But they really needed to get at least a couple kills on the Night Stalker to send him into that next 6 minutes of daytime.
Yeah. So EG just group up four heroes at the very last point. It's like if Quantic do want to push this last remaining tier one tower, then that's fine. They can do that because they've got Black Hole up. They've got Mech up as well from Enigma. And they've got 1 point up in that null field. And now they're going to smoke and go. Are they going in for Roshan? I think they are.
Yep. Yeah, they've started it.
Protection wall went up there by Universe. And it was a deep ward as well by Universe. Very high up on the hill. They want to know the second Quantic make a move for them. Because it's going to take them a small amount of time to get through Roshan. It's copying them a lot of stuns, as those conversions are going to die. And this can be where the heroes start to take a little bit of damage. But it should be enough time for them. And Quantic are in no position to defend this. In fact, top lane, just the pressure coming out by Bulba, it's going to split off their attention anyway. And there's Morphling with an Aegis, and the tree comes in too late. Dire's middle tower is under attack.
This is just getting worse and worse for Quantic at this point. They're trying to do everything they can. It's just Morphling had too good of a start.
It's really effective play here by EG. And this is something which I was really looking forward to see if they could keep on doing throughout this tournament. As EG, they were struggling. They were really struggling before they started off this boot camp. And I think a lot of people would have put EG to be one of the first four or first eight to be removed from the international too. But from what we've been seeing over the last couple of matches and through other tournaments as well EG been playing in, you've got to say they're looking good. They're looking really good. It's nice and coordinated. Their lanes are working for them. But this is also Quantic unable to make the most out of their own lanes. This bottom lane of Tidehunter just didn't work for them. This offlane Tide is failing for a lot of teams of late. And this Ravage, there's just been, like, Tide has not popped this Ravage a single time because there's been no opportunity for it. EG is split pushing nicely. They're keeping the pressure up. And they're dropping down Painted Gold's life before he can get in. And that makes him really think twice about jumping in.
He just got a lot of long-range spells that they can use just to harass these support heroes that really don't have the HP pool to stand up to it. And that's, like, Quantic is investing a lot into this mid lane push, but you see, EG only has to use 4 to defend while Fear farms.
And Fear can join him in just a TP because the tier 1 tower is still up. And that's Quantic. One thing Quantic don't have. All their tier 1 towers are gone.
Yeah, and they're pushing with five, so they're always losing out on a little bit of that farm.
That's why Painted Gold's now here inside the jungle, looking for his own form of farm.
And Quantic realized that they can't be forced into this game of go for a tower while Fear farms.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it just doesn't work for them. I don't know what Prophet was doing with that TP. I don't think that was 100% intentional. Just TP, the most ridiculous distance. Might have been because Kurok was heading top and he was thinking about going up there. And Kurok is now farming up that top lane. But what we are seeing from EG, they are playing very, very defensive. Nyasorka is still getting stronger and stronger. If we want to look at this late game, we've still got to look at the impact you're going to have from Nature's Prophet. He's running Hand of Blindness. You've still got the global control that can come out from him. And then you've got Nyasorka's tank ability, plus the increase during the night time, and that's going to cause havoc for the extra heroes of EG. And I'm talking about Rubick, I'm talking about Windrunner, I'm talking about Enigma, I'm talking about Crystal Maiden. Morphling won't care at all. He's now got enough money to buy a shotgun, and that's going to mean easy kills for him when he looks at the Venomancer, but only the Venomancer. He can't burst down anybody else.
And maybe Nature's Prophet.
Yeah, to an extent, Nature's Prophet. And that's just because he's still running that Hand of Myers, which makes him very, very fragile for now. But Nature's Prophet is also a buyback TP kind of guy.
Yeah.
Which is easy Aegis to the Immortal. But it's going to come down a lot to this next nighttime cycle. The first one wasn't as successful, but it wasn't horrible for Nightstalkery. Again, it was maybe one death to his name, so that's not great in anybody's books. But it's enough to hold the line until the next nighttime cycle. He's got Strength Treads, Vanguard, Urn. So he's looking good on 1500 HP. He can tank up that Morphling pretty easily.
He's doing well. The problem is the Venomancer is looking pretty raw. I mean, Leshrac's got a few more items, a little bit more gold, not really that much more. Mm-hmm. I mean, you've got most of the farm at this point on the Tidehunter and the Nightstalker. And that's good to have, it's just you have so little farm on the rest of these heroes, and now we're going to have Bulba actually spy out Painted Gold here.
Yeah, he's trying to chase him down. But Painted Gold moves the right way. Moves a little bit further down, and Matrim was coming in support. And just Matrim rotating them, Bulbasaur it with the ward. And he's got his own plague ward up there as well, so he's keeping vision on where EG are moving. We look at Nature's Prophet on the top lane. If Malk, if only he had a Blink Dagger, he'd be killing off Brax right now.
Yeah.
But then again, Kurok's just like, you know what? You know what time it is? It's death time. It's death time, man. Couple of seconds, it's gonna be night time for him. And then he can start hunting whoever he wants.
And the other thing I've noticed about EG is when they're in a position where you'd think that Crystal Maiden's an easy target for Night Stalker, even Rubick and Windrunner to an extent, not really. But they just play so well positionally that Crystal Maiden never really is within a step of an enemy or of an allied hero. Mm-hmm. So Crystal Maiden's just playing with incredibly good positioning to keep her team away from giving those free kills up.
Yeah. And that's just a smart support player. Leave the other boys on the front lines to get those stuns in. We're looking at middle lane here. Korok losing a large portion of his damage. But he's now got 9 stick charges when he's going to dive this one. We have hit that second nighttime phase now. So the teeth open up, the wings wide spread. And Kurok's going to start looking for blood. And the middle lane, wow, Demon is so close. Oh, there Demon. Goes the Gale, Void as well. Tied, this time pop the Ravage, but wonderful yields up there by Demon. Goes straight up towards the air. Spit Earth will hit, but there's a lot of damage already being done. Nova did his job. Kurok wants out. Wonderful shackle there by Bulba. Kurok already being shotgunned down here by Fear, but not the full hit. And that means Kurok will have time to get Nurn charge off. Fear won't have enough damage to finish him off. And nobody going down just yet, but wait, there you go. Pain of Gold takes a fall here from EG. And Rubick brought back into the game. He directly brought back into the game so he can come and be part of that fight. And EG will want to make Quantic hurt.
But that
hurt EG more. Yeah, that hurt EG a lot more.
And it was surprising because the Ravage hit on nothing. Mm-hmm.
But that was also good timing there by Demon. That would have also been the moment from Pain at Gold where he's like, I see this hit. I want to stun him before that Yule Scepter goes off. But Demon was too fast on the fingers for him. And he thought that stun might have lasted a little bit longer, but Split Earth is... Well, actually, no, Split Earth's level 4.
Well, Split Earth lasts the same amount of time. Mm-hmm. 2 seconds, no matter what level. But it's the fact that Demon, I think, may have been up that hill just a little bit. And Tidehunter lost sight. I'm not sure.
We got rotation bot lane.
It's one of those things you're like, we're really invested in killing this Rubick. Better Ravage to get it done.
Mm-hmm. Matrim really wants to come in close, but while that replicate is there, he knows he cannot. And EG are going to keep this momentum going on the bot lane. They know they're being pushed in the middle lane. Bulba will stand to defend. And there's 4 heroes adding pressure towards the bot lane. And that's why Tide plus Matrim here to defend. But there's that rotation off to the side lanes. This is something which EG cannot do. And that's that easy split lane push to come out from Nature's Prophet. And he can pop the old one if things get too rough on the bottom lane. And the fact that Mech is up on Prophet too, he can let his team take a little bit of damage, then TP himself in, give that much needed heal. So it's all about stayability, side lane push, and keep EG wasting time as they rotate between their lanes.
Yeah, but EG is doing a good job being aggressive during the nighttime. And what this does is it means that Night Stalker doesn't really have the same amount of power as he normally does. You see Night Stalker wants to get involved in these 2v1 fights or these 1v1 fights. He's not nearly as strong in the 5v5 situation, and that's what EG has been forcing whenever it's nighttime.
Mm-hmm.
And he still does have his silence, which is a good skill, especially against heroes like Rubick and Enigma. But he still doesn't have that same raw advantage that he'd normally have when he's in his most strong point.
Well, most of the time he'd have either CS or he'd have kills. At this point, his CS has just clocked over 100, same for Tidehunter. But you look at Enigma, 153 for him, and 152 for 52 on that Morphling. He's looking really, really good, Fear. And that's with some kills behind him as well. 4-0 for Fear.
And those are all lane creeps as well, whereas Enigma's more jungle creeps.
Radiant's top tower has fallen.
Another tower for Morphling to pick up. So now he's only 600, 700 gold away from having that full Manta style. And Kurok during this second nighttime phase, force a defend. And surprisingly, he hasn't popped that ultimate off just yet. They're still just sitting there with, it's only level 1 ultimate, poor guy. But he can extend the nighttime using that ultimate, but he's just holding on to it for now.
Yeah, he wants to get level 11 and then he'll pop it, just because it lasts a lot longer. And as I say that, he pops at level 10.
He's like, screw it, it's gonna take me longer than 25 seconds to get that, that level 11. Or maybe not, I'm gonna laugh if he pops it here in the middle lane. At the same time, Prophet looks like he got brought down the bottom lane, my bad. Ty's checking for the Invis rune. EG's already setting up. Second Roshan time now, 24 minutes in. And Quantic can't defend this. Prophet can probably come in there in 24 seconds, but they know that's too long. EG will easily mop up Roshan in that time.
Yeah, nothing that Quantic can do to defend this, even with their full Ravage Venomancer combo. They just get Black Hold in there and then it's game over.
Uh-huh.
So.
Life is hell.
And Morphling has his Manta style.
Well, we knew that one was going to be coming up, and it's going to be a painful thing with him with his Aegis the Immortal on top of it all. And Rubik bought a Blink Dagger. Who else? We had another Blink Dagger come up as well. So it's Windrunner plus Rubik who has the Blink Dagger. And we've been seeing this from so many Windrunners as well. They just don't feel they can get themselves into a great position. So they Four Staff and Blink Dagger. Basically meaning that whatever position Bobble wants to get into during a team fight, he can do so. So easily as well. Start with a Blink, go with the Force, and you can latch people out of complete position. Now we're going to have Ravage on the bottom lane. This is all just to kill off Melk, and it's well worth it. He will go down as well.
Brax mid lane got blown up by Bulba with that Blink Dagger being used. It just lets him basically
go bot lane again, man. Demon's caught out. He got sent up in the air by his own Yule Scepter, but he's on the run. There's no real run away from this one. Is there another Void? Yeah, there is, and the Urn Charge will tick him. Universe was turning around looking for a denial, but at the same point, we're going to see Fear take out the middle lane with support by Bulba. Mikey doing what he can to stop this, but there is a, one siege creep that's stopping the backdoor regen from kicking in. So Fortification is forced. Kurok's running back down the middle lane, going to look for a straggler, but look at that shotgun by Fear. There's the blink in. Gosh, Anchor Smash, Fear, he wants to jump out of this one. Bulba's going to land a power shot, and Fear might have just enough damage to stay alive for this one. He's definitely got that strength morph going up to 1400, 1500. Realizing with that Urn Charge on top of him, he needs a little bit more life. He goes up to 2k. There's a blink in. Gush as well. Let's say screw it. We cannot kill Fear. Let's just go for Windrunner. Kurok's out of mana. He's got 3 stick charges up his sleeve.
Great
and
blink.
They cannot find anybody. They didn't keep that right click going on Bola with that Windrun blocking it off. So he's able to blink himself away, not having that Blink Dagger on cooldown. And Melk was coming in to support too. Looks like he spent his cash for a BKB.
I'm surprised that Fear got out of that. I thought there was going to be more damage, but it's the problem that Leshrac and Venno have. They don't have enough strength to stay in these fights. We need that continuous damage out of everybody. Own Brax.
Yeah, he's doing what he can to try and search for farm. But also he just created trees, which he just gave the demon. There's the buyback by Prophet. He'll pop the ult to try and stop this middle lane push. But Fear won't really care. He can right click down this mid ranks with no real issue whatsoever. There goes the Gush out, or maybe he was going to try to, but the Mana Star went to start with. And Demon steals Split Earth, follows up with a Fade Bolt. Mid ranks is brought down. And EG don't need to overextend right now, but they feel pretty confident. They've still got Black Hole, and there goes Venomancer popping out as well. They know Tide Ravage is currently on cooldown. 13 seconds left to go. Gush will fly, power shot as well. A lot of damage already taken up by Brax. Forced to pop this mech off, and EG, they're happy to fall back. Venom ulti also went down, including Venomancer himself. So doesn't matter when he respawns if they'll be coming back up again. And maybe EG waiting around for a straggler, but no one going to oblige from by Quantic.
Quantic's still running into a lot of problems. In terms of, they don't have an answer for Morphling at this point. Morphling's just getting more and more money every fight.
Mm-hmm. And looking at right now, he's going to see if he can snipe off Mikey.
He
and
can.
Mikey's in range. Mikey is perfectly
HP,
in range.
It's close, but if you look, Morphling's only at 3
Rax going
to
go down bot. Bulba's here.
He's going for it.
He's going to. And one right click. There he gets it. Yeah, 17 seconds to jump out to that replicant. So he'll TP, regen, and then come back to his replicant. Which at this point is moving up towards the top lane. So this will be the next pressure point from EG. It's a slow and calculating match. One upside now for Quantic is still the fact that Tide's got that blink dagger. That's also the option if he wants it to try and finish up that hood. But he split himself between Vanguard and hood. He's got vitality boost just so he can live. And then having the cloak. And who are they going to find? Well, hello Bulba. Blink in, anchor smash and gush. But they now realize Tide's out of position. Matchroom's also out of position. That's why both are TPing back. And Fear just starts again now on the tier 3 tower. Finding Mikey, waves down, there goes the shotty, but 26 HP he'll live on. Fear will get one last right click off. His strength morphing himself through this one, but it's not going to be enough life. But the Aegis Immortal is there. So it will pop. Nova Harassment, Malk coming into position. He's got the BKB Black Hole, which he still hasn't managed to use just yet. Now Korok's going to make his bit of a move. Blink in, nice Ravage. Malk, he's got to put the BKB. Now the Black Hole to go. Going to pick up Korok plus Painted Gold. So right click by Fear. Wave over the top. Has he got Ethereal Blade? Yeah, he does. And there goes two kills for Fear. This, my friends, is what's called a good game. First game will go the way here of Evil Genius. He's going to take out the top racks. And Morphling again just sniping off the Venomancer. So top racks is gone though. Gonna rotate middle lane and ensure the mid racks goes down fully as well. And then possibly take out the bot lane. And Ty goes the only safe place, and that's not in Sire's base. Matchroom quite rightly so. Unable to understand what the hell just happened to his life points. And Morphling finds himself another kill. There's a GG call waiting for. So 421. 30 minutes and 30 seconds it took for EG to take this GG. Which is the perfect time for a Morphling to get completely out of control.
He's completely out of control about 10 minutes ago, but yes, I totally agree with that.
And this is just one of those fun little moments. Is he really?
Brax is just trying to get that mid tower. He's been trying to get it for a while.
Yeah, he might be able to bring down Bolt if he's careful. Is there a gush? Yeah, he's looking. Nope, oh. Shackle, Bulba, just too good. Blinks away. Avoiding Painted Gold. Stick charges, someone else. We've got the GG happening back inside of base. And he runs up, runs back down again. There's the gush. Blink anchor. Painted Gold will finally bring him down. Best of three though, guys. This is game number one. The defense playoff. We shall return shortly. Quantic going up against EG, Winner will face up against the winner of Mouse Force versus Bottom Bottom. That match happening this Thursday. All these games need to be finished up by the end of Saturday for our grand final on Sunday. That's right, we're in the last couple of days of the defense. So stick around, we shall return. Thank you very much to Fear, who is actually agility morphing himself so he can finally kill off the racks. So he can finally see our stat board. But EG looking strong, Quantic. They're going to have a lot of questions to answer in this next draft, plus their laning phase in the next game, because they cannot do what happened this game, or else they're going to find themselves being eliminated 2-0. Not the path they want to go on, considering they managed to get so far through this. Into the semi-finals, knocked down to face up against Evil Geniuses, who have been working their way through the slower bracket, through AL, through MTW, through SGC. Every single game was 2-0. Will they take this one the same way? Stick around, you will find out. Game number two coming up in a couple moments' time.
I said good day, sir!